is the council workshop on the municipal side of the budget for fiscal year 1993. What we are starting with is a $4.1 million budget that has been prepared by the department heads and the manager. Our job is going to be a continuation of our responsibility as policy setters. And I think we had a good reminder of that from Councilor Chapel the other evening when we dealt with the school board, that that is what we are basically responsible for doing. Doing that in light with the budget, because the budget is going to reflect our policies. It's going to ultimately tell what we want our town to be and what our community values are. In the budget and through these policies, we decide what services are offered, what levels of services are expected, and the levels of delivery that we're going to provide. And I think in my growth as a counselor during the budget sessions, I've come more and more to realize how much the budget reflects the policies. I've always in the past said, and sometimes I think moaned to the manager, that, but we're setting policy. We don't really ever say that. And that's something I'm going to be focusing on a lot today. And I think we can do that in every discussion with every part of the budget. That's part of the format that I want us to follow. We're going to be talking about probably four levels of budget types of expenditures. We're going to be talking about absolute necessities. We're going to be talking about needs, niceties, and then some items that may become negligible. I'll be going back to those words during the day. Make sure that what we are saying for budget figures are going to reflect our policy thinking. I really want to focus on that. I also want us to have a long-term focus with our budget decisions. We all know that serves us well. We know how trapped and inefficient the operation becomes when we have a short-term focus, and I want us to get away from that as much as possible. I think we generally do a very good job of that, and I want us to continue. I think all of these are very sound business tenets. We have the business of the town before us in the budget, and we're going to be applying some of these business tenets. When we were in Augusta with the MMA-sponsored meeting with the legislators, one of the speakers spoke of having rigid ends and flexible means. I think that's a very good way to deal with the budget also. The policies and priorities become the rigid ends, and then what we do with some of the monetary figures can be a little more flexible to get us to those rigid ends. The format I want to follow today when the department heads are here, and then for some of the items where we don't have department head presentations, is to go through an introduction from the department head, or in other cases from the manager, have a council discussion of our overall expectations and policies for that discussion, for that department or issue. Not a long one, but I want to make sure that's the basis for our discussion of the budget for that particular department. And then we'll get into specific questions from counselors about the budget requests. I want to thank the manager and the department heads for their work on this budget. I found it very useful in the summaries in the front to have the expenditures by category. That was very helpful. Another difference in the budget this year is that the salaries are put within, the salaries and benefits are put within each individual department. Made it a little more difficult, perhaps, in going back to try to do some comparisons with previous budgets. But I think that will serve us well, especially in the next two or three years when we get used to dealing with it like that. But I think it's a much more accurate accounting of each department's expenditures. And I, for one, appreciated that. We don't have the notebooks this year. We have spiral bound, which right there was a very nice cost savings. I commend Barbara Ray, I guess, for being responsible for that. I think it's a terrific way to get us started. And we'll turn it over to you, Mike, and let you do your
just answer. As an example, I think these books cost half to print and put together what last year's book did. And you know, it's indicative of everything that we're trying to do to find a way to shave a nickel or a dime off our municipal spending. I missed the last town council meeting back beginning of the month. So I was unable to give a budget message at that point. I understand that Debbie did give a fairly good summary and did share some of my thoughts. I did, never did watch the meeting on cable, perhaps I should have, but I didn't. But nonetheless, I think there's a few important points that I'd like to stress at the beginning. One is that, you know, there's been a lot of talk about, or a lot of sense that, you know, why is the town manager looking for this big increase this year? You know, what's he up to, and all those sorts of questions and issues. I think it's important when we look at the numbers that we do all recall that the budget, while it is up significantly from last year, it is only up 3.5% over 2 years, which is roughly one half the rate of inflation. So this budget is in essence proposing that we absorb one half of the inflation during the last 2 years by savings throughout the area. An additional point I'd like to make is one thing that's even difficult to stay within the 3.5% is that when we look at some of the things that additional issues that we've been looking at over the last few years and some of the cost areas and the way they've been increasing. Obviously, last year there was a 5% salary increase in a time when the budget was reduced significantly. Because of that, last year it was necessary to cut out a lot of other things. We've also seen a very large increase in hydrant and fire protection charges in this year's budget. Between that and water rates, it's about $41,000. Workers' comp costs have continued to increase. We have a ladder truck issue that we're facing and that needs to be dealt with today and over the next month or two. We have a revaluation that definitely needs to be considered in order to equalize tax rates. We have a community center that I think everyone is now proud of, but yet now needs to be maintained. We have an addition to the public works garage that is now there and needs to be maintained. Those two facilities also add $60,000 in principal payments to our debt service costs that were not there last year. And I remember when Jane voted against one of those projects, she was commenting that we'd probably rue the day we'd have to pay for it. Well, I don't, you know, I think it was a very necessary project and you know, a terrific investment, and I fully support both projects. However, the day is here where we do have to pay for it, and it does have about a $60,000 impact on the budget. And, you know, I think the point I'm trying to make is, you know, it's the budget and the policies, as Janet mentioned, have been a lot goals-based, but you know, a lot of the goals you begin to have to pay for. And, you know, at this point, we're beginning to have to pay for them, and I know, you know, during the process, we've got to reconsider what we did previously. In order to, you know, determine what the new priorities are. And I think this budget does that. You know, we've tried to shave in a lot of different areas, but those areas where we're being forced to add on, we are doing that. In addition to that, I'd like to, some of you may have picked up your mail in your box this morning and saw my schedule for next month and looked at it and wondered. One thing that I have been doing, particularly since the beginning of the year, is spend an awful lot of time externally, not with some of the internal operations. That's for three reasons. The first is because I just happened in my career to gravitate towards some positions that at this time that caused some outside work. But second from that is my sense is the internal operations are in pretty good shape. And I think, you know, when you listen to all the department heads today, you'll be reinforced with your belief that we have good department heads that are very dedicated and that are looking to provide the best possible services at the lowest possible cost. The third reason why I've been spending a lot of time outside is, I think, an area that directly affects this budget, and that's the fact that so many of the pressures that we're feeling on the budget at this point are, in fact, external pressures. I think Cape Elizabeth should be pleased with the leadership roles that so many people in this community have shown in trying to reduce cost. I think, you know, the work Lester Jordan did and has done with the regional waste systems when he was on the board, and now we're up to bring in new communities to keep the per ton cost from going up too much. I think some of the work, definitely the work that the town council started on the Portland Water District rate case. You know, there's a potential savings there of over $1 million. Over the next 10 or so years, and that case looks like it's coming along fairly good. The public advocate clearly sided with us this week. The staff is taking a position very close to the towns. The hearing examiner still needs to rule, but again, you know, I think that's time well spent. This past week, I was part of a group that reported out on workers' comp, that could save us about 40% of our workers' comp costs. For the town of Cape Elizabeth, that's an $80,000 savings. I spent an awful lot of time, and I know councilors did some work in trying to save revenue sharing. The state government proposed last November eliminating revenue sharing. We have a revenue of $325,000 in this budget that would not have been there if we hadn't spent that time externally. We also have, you know, department heads. Debbie is very active in the New England Clerks Association. As I understand it, got together one night after a meeting, and they were discussing where they got their election ballots. And as a result of just that discussion among the clerks one evening, Deborah has found a new source of election ballots that's one half the cost of what we were paying before. Chief Pickering has been very active. He teaches law enforcement in the evenings part-time at Southern Maine Technical College, particularly law enforcement administration. I think that type of external work helps out as well. Bob Malley is organizing a rally of public works equipment, almost like a trade show, but also with the employees would go and have contests on different things, and something I think that, you know, enhances training, enhances morale. I could go on and on, you know, about, you know, Jerry Daigle being a member of the International Board of Assessing Officials, Wayne, the work that he's been doing with the National League of Cities, Jane, although it's not tied directly to Cape Elizabeth, the State Board of Education work. But I think as we look at all those things, all of it, you know, we were sitting here with the school board the other night, all of that outside knowledge helps Cape Elizabeth to continue to maintain not only a leadership role externally, but also a role that really helps us internally. Wayne had sent a letter to Dana Connors last week about complaining about the road turn back. And, you know, I think because of the credibility of this community, we were asked to have a representative serve on a four-member committee to look at the issue and to not have, you know, the turn back in the condition that they are. The point I'm driving at is, you know, I think, you know, a lot of the reason we're able to do all those things is because the municipal government in this town is respected, and I think that's been through a couple decades of hard work by selectmen, by a lot of the volunteers in this community, by the council and by the staff. And you know, my sense is that this budget, again, may be a turning point, and I think, you know, we need to continue to try to, you know, do the best job that we can to provide the best possible services and to do all we can both internally and externally to make sure that the services are being provided most efficiently and that we're getting the most we can out of external sources and at the same time trying to keep those costs down. That's my opening summary.
Sorry, we're caught up from your missing that meeting.
Well, that isn't what I would have said at the beginning of the month.
Just so the councilors know that there are a couple of minor revisions in the schedule for today. The first one will be our first department we're going to talk with this morning will be emergency preparedness, moving that up rather than, and then to be followed by the police department. And this afternoon,
George is going to come in closer to two.
Okay. Number 510, the library, we'll be discussing around two rather than at the end of the afternoon, the closer to the beginning of the afternoon. Probably helpful just for people who may be watching this at home to give the order that we think we're going to be doing this in today. This morning, we will first have emergency preparedness, police department, animal control, dispatching, wet team, fire department, miscellaneous public protection, public safety building, and engine one. We're hoping to conclude with all of that by 10:30, and then start with parks, trees, public works, refuse disposal, sewer, and Riverside Cemetery. We will take a 1 hour lunch break and leave the premises to do that. Hopefully getting back as close to one as possible, starting with administration, assessing and codes, planning, town council, elections, boards and commissions, insurance, employee benefits, and debt service. And then around 2 o'clock, start with library, human services, general assistance, contributions, cable TV, town hall, community center, rental units, Spurwink Church, intergovernmental assessments, and payroll issues. I do want people who may be watching today to understand that this is the council's working session. We do not take public comment at this session, and I do not intend to take public comment at this session. On Monday night, which is March 30th, we do have scheduled a neighborhood meeting where you can come and talk to us about anything you want. We're holding that starting 7:30 at the community center at 1226 Shore Road. I know one member of the public's already spoken to me, said he will be coming and talking to us about the budget at that point. It's not scheduled as a budget public hearing, but that's certainly a very appropriate time for people to come and talk to us about concerns about the budget. It's also very appropriate to put those kinds of concerns in writing to us, and that way they get your written comments do get distributed to every councilor, regardless of whom you direct them to. So just that the public understands that there is an available process for you to make your thoughts known to us. Other upcoming meetings for this finance committee include next Thursday, April 2nd, 7:30, here in council chambers. We will again be meeting with the school department to get an update on their deliberations after our direction to them the other evening about financing some of their capital improvements. On next Thursday, April 2nd, we also will be talking, we will be reviewing the community services budget that we've all received a little while ago. Monday, April 13th is our regular council meeting. At that time, we expect to set 2 public hearing, a review of the budget. That public hearing most likely will be scheduled for the second Monday in May, which is our regular meeting on May 11th. It's always possible, and we generally have perhaps at least one other meeting as a finance committee to resolve some budget issues that hasn't been scheduled yet. That's the schedule as you know it right now. Our town charter requires that we adopt our budget by May 30th. It would be certainly a load off our shoulders to get it done before that. And what we would aim for right now is the May 11th meeting. Do any other councilors have comments? Opening comments they want to make before we get started today.
Just at some point we need to have revenues come into that is on the list.
That's not on the list, okay.
If we get a little bit ahead of ourselves in time today.
Why not right now? 10 minutes ahead of
me. No, we're not.
Oh,
no. Emergency preparedness has arrived. We're all ready. Good time.
Come on, sorry I'm late.
No, you're not at all.
Take your car.
You have time to settle in, get comfortable.
Relax.
I was dancing, so.
Keep going. All right. I have 10 options.
Greg Tinsman is our Director of Emergency Preparedness. He's with us to start our morning. Greg, I've said I want the follow the procedures to be is for you to give an introduction to us for your department. We'll have a real quick discussion about our vision for emergency preparedness, our expectations for that department, and then we'll give you some specific questions if there are any.
Okay. Do you want a description of what we do? Or?
I think that would be helpful. I know Councilor Chappell is well versed in it, but in a recent discussion you and I had was how many more emergencies. Weather seems to be really hitting us a lot harder since Councilor Chappell resigned from that position. I don't know what the significance is.
You're talking about me again.
Well, at least you're listening.
this past year we had 3 emergencies where we had to activate emergency preparedness. And what we do is we coordinate emergency services with the police and the fire. And we open evacuation shelters if they're necessary. We work with the Red Cross and any agency that would be involved. We had 2 hurricanes this past year, plus a coastal storm. last winter, I believe it was in February, and our main concern is coastal areas, flooding, and getting people out of two lights, Hanford Cove Road, and the areas that, that might be in danger. Hurricane Bob came in August, and what we had to do was, we opened an evacuation shelter at the high school. Hurricane Grace came in October, and that was actually worse than Hurricane Bob. And what we have for a problem is people coming to the rocks to see exactly what type of storm we could get, the waves and the surf. They don't seem to understand the dangers of a hurricane. And the police department, and the fire department for that matter, are really stressed as far as manpower, all over town with down wires and down limbs and that sort of thing. So that's where emergency preparedness kind of takes over. We organize with the town manager different areas of town that have to be addressed. We shut off Two Lights Road, Kettle Cove, on storms that come from the south. If a storm were to come from a more easterly fashion, we'd be more concerned with Shore Road. Shore Road has to be shut off a lot of times too, down by Janice House. We'll probably lose that someday. But emergency preparedness, what we do is basically coordinate, and there's a lot of planning involved in whatever contingency might happen. Irv Chappell was responsible for our current procedures and basically everything that we do. We've identified some of the more hazardous things that could happen to Cape. In the 50s and 60s, it was probably nuclear war. Now we're more concerned with coastal storms, chemical spills, and maybe an accident at a nuclear power plant, something of that nature. And it's basically coordinating and evacuating people and keeping in touch with the Cumberland County officials and the state officials and even, to some extent, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA. I met with FEMA after Hurricane Bob, and they had declared Cumberland County a disaster area. And we got some funds from that. I'm not sure exactly how much we got, but... Your emergency preparedness director is responsible for compiling a list of all the damages and costs that the federal government will reimburse us for. So it's basically an everything job. It's time consuming, more time consuming than I thought when I took over. I'm sure Irv will agree to that. And that's basically it.
What do you hope to accomplish with emergency preparedness in the coming year, besides, since you can't control the weather?
It's hard to say what the weather will do. Last year we worked on evacuation plans, and we may have to update our procedures manual and keep it updated. But basically everything runs itself down there. What we have to be concerned with is the emergency operating center, which is the bunker at Fort Williams, to maintain that and to keep that from falling in disrepair. We have antennas, we have cables that are exposed to the elements down there that we're going to have to repair over the next year. Basically everything down there is working well. We've been able to save money in the budget. We're going to be returning We're going to be returning a couple rental phones and buying one phone. That's going to save us about $90 a year. The alarm system at the bunker has been modified to save us even more money. So
that kind of cost savings sounds small, but it's always appreciated.
Oh, absolutely.
When a department head will make the effort to look into it with even small savings like that do accumulate over the years.
As you look at the entire budget, for civil emergency preparedness, the Bureau of Emergency Preparedness. It's unchanged last year, except we have added Social Security and workers' comp to the account as part of other departments.
Do counselors have any general comments about the operation, the overall operation of emergency preparedness? Or things that you would like to see in general happen, or any expounding on the goals that Greg has mentioned?
I just had one clarification, Greg. With the issue of Cumberland County being determined a, you know, a federal disaster area based on these hurricanes, do we, the entity of Cape Elizabeth, do we get any funding per se, I mean, to help in our emergency preparedness program? Does that offset, I mean, any of the budget, or does that directly go to homeowners who have sustained damages?
That goes directly to homeowners and actually to the town itself for operating expenses during the hurricane. What they're concerned with is, and basically what they tell us at the very beginning, we'll give you enough money and the state will help out as well to repair your town from the damage to make it whole again. If we received, if the town hall were to fall down, they'd fix it. Basically, that's what it is. If Shore Road, that area along where it's exposed to the ocean at Pond Cove, if that were to completely be demolished and fall into the sea, they would repair it, but they'd even go a couple steps beyond it to repair it so that it didn't happen again. But as has happened in the past few storms, it hasn't gotten to that point yet. And what they do is they just patch it. But to answer your question, they don't give us enough money to operate for the year or anything beyond the cost of the storm. They will only repair the damages that have been done during the storm or whatever declared the area a disaster.
For the first hurricane, we received $22,008 back in federal funds, about 10% of that in state funds. For the second storm, the only damage we had was a little bit down at the little roadway or pathway going to Crescent Beach, plus the fence down at Fulton Headlight was destroyed. And for that storm, it was a couple $1,000. We checked in yesterday, I think it was.
So that's money that comes directly to the town?
That's right. Yeah,
not to individuals?
No, it doesn't go back to individual departments.
Does that go in our general fund then? Mm-hmm. Yes. Thank you, that's what I wanted to know.
And there is an error on your sheets on the telephone, on the cover letter. I noticed a typo yesterday when I was going over it. Our monthly telephone bill is not $90 a month. It's $40 a month.
Janet?
Yes, sir.
Greg, I want to congratulate you on the last 2 years. I've been watching it very closely, and it's a great job.
Thank you.
The thing I think that is important for the council, though, and I know I had an awful job getting it through to one when I was director, is that when have you had the last visit from a counselor down there? Don't answer the question.
Okay.
Okay. The second thing is that they worry about you staying busy. They don't realize the number of hours per year that you're going to get in for this so-called charity. I figure you're making about 62 cents an hour.
Well, that's
and the because FEMA are famous for knowing when your workload is very small and adding things on to make it very large. They don't like plans that are good. They want them made better each year, and that's what keeps you busy. I just thought those general comments might be, you know.
Yeah,
but I'm pleased with what that $3,500, you should get that hands down just like that.
Thank you for your comments, sir. I appreciate it. I had some pretty big shoes to fill when I took over, and it's been easy having a procedures manual that's all ready to go. I mean, that takes a lot of time to prepare.
All right, Councilor Chappell, I have been to Bunker recently.
Okay.
Twice in the past year I've been down there.
She signed in, too.
I signed in. And
I invite any one of the counselors to come down anytime.
Very interesting.
That's what it looks like.
It is fascinating. Anybody hasn't been down there, and I haven't. I never had, you know, Brownie or Boy Scout in my family who went on the tours down there. That's how a lot of parents get in. But I think it's worth knowing. It's utterly fascinating what is hidden from view inside that bunker. And there are costs, yes. We hope we will never have to use those. So let us go then to page.
Just a minute, I'll ask you. You think any major expenses you're going to do to the bunker here in the future?
Yeah, the major thing that we're going to be working on are the antennas and the cable leading to them, because they've been, over the years, they've been exposed to the elements, and the salt spray has kind of taken toll on them. But that should be covered under the building maintenance account.
How about the conditions of the bunker inside? Do you have anything left there?
Basically, that's in good shape. There is a little area in the generator room where the roofs or the ceilings are falling in. And I think that could be, it's not a structure problem, it's more of a underneath the cement part. It's starting just to fall off, I think, and that's due to the moisture and the humidity in there. So I don't think we have any major tasks ahead of us. The steel door was damaged by some vandals about a month ago, and that's going to be repaired. I was thinking about replacing the steel door, but what we're going to do is try to just work with what we have. And it's a real strong door, so they can't get in. It's alarmed anyway. But we're going to fix that too.
Good question. Thank you for talking about long-term maintenance. If counselors will turn to page 113 in the budget book. And we will do our traditional flipping of the pages here. If there are any specific questions on any of the line items, part-time payroll. This is in keeping with the general policy of a 0% increase, be it a stipend or a salary for this year. Telephone. Power. Radio maintenance. Building maintenance, heat, miscellaneous supplies. Not too many pages with this one. Carl.
I just have one question. Mm-hmm. Right? Included in miscellaneous supplies, would that handle any equipment repairs to the generator, or is that covered under power?
The power account is basically separate main power.
Okay.
The miscellaneous supplies would be more office supplies or whatever FEMA wants, you know, maybe some publications that we might buy during the course of the year. Anything to do with the generator would come under building maintenance.
Okay. In response to that question, Bob, with the exception of over or underspending the payroll account, the rest of this budget it's more responsive to needs than to actually keeping within these line items. The line items are there, but you know, as the year goes on, particularly with the bunker down there, things go bad, and you know, one account may be overspent by three times, while another one doesn't get spent at all.
Okay, no, I just wanted to know.
Maybe overall totals may be
overspent. But there's funds available for that purpose.
Yeah, we're trying to do some of that.
I think what you're hearing is a common concern for maintenance, and I think this council is very aware of the need for an annual regular maintenance schedule, and all of us as homeowners are aware of that too. That's a long-term outlook that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
We will continue to support that. Any other questions for Greg? Thank you for being here.
Well, you're welcome. It's good to get up early in the morning.
Nice of you to bring Lindsay.
Yeah. My secretary.
She's still sleeping.
Yeah, she's still asleep.
She's already softball.
I don't envy you people for the rest of the day, but it's going to be a long day.
You can stay with us.
Well, you know, I'll come back.
Thanks so much.
Thank you, Greg. I would propose a slight revision to the agenda and consider taking wet team next. Another, I'm getting a bigger nod from the audience. Another smaller item, and then we can get into the police department. Are there any objections to that?
No objections.
Okay. With us we have Doug Timsman, the director of, is that your title, director for wet team?
I think so.
That doesn't matter. For counselors, this is item 225 on page 97. Again, what we're hoping to do is have your introduction, have general policy discussions, if any are applicable from the counselors, and we'll get into the flipping of the pages.
Okay, I don't know what you'd like to hear, but
basically, this year on the budget for the WET team, we have tried to categorize the appropriations for the coming year, and this is the first time it's been done. It's hoped that we've hit it right on target, but it's, you know, even though we've put these in categories, our budget, I think, would lend itself more towards what actually unfolds during the coming year rather than specifically to these items. We've tried to make an effort to break it down into categories, but we'll know better next year how this works. Mm-hmm. Last year, this was under the 210-4002, and the only real differences other than the categorizing would be the addition of the incident command van. And those expenditures are guessed to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $700, $750 for the operation of that van. And that basically is the difference between last year's budget and this year's. We've tried to keep a zero increase. As you'll note, we're down considerably from our 1991 request, which was $5,600. And as you notice, that was all spent and very wisely done with that. So we're trying to keep it down to bare bones. We think we can work with that. That's where we are. Our team consists of 16 members. We have one intern this year. We're trying to increase the membership to 20 from 16. That will be done very carefully and very deliberately. We know exactly the type of person that would fit the mode for a water extrication team member, and we're very selective in the process.
If somebody is interested, how would they find out about that criteria?
Applications are on hand at the Public Safety Building.
Is there a listing of the criteria that you're looking for?
More or less.
Okay.
More or less.
Yes.
More or less. Yeah. We're establishing a policy guideline and also some bylaws at this time. Good. They've been slow in coming about, but we're working towards that. Mm-hmm.
Jane?
Doug, how many times was the WET team called upon last year for
Last year, we probably were called out three or four times. Not as much as the first year. But we do have 12 regular scheduled training sessions a year for the members, plus about two unscheduled drills that are unannounced and unscheduled. We also have this year six business meetings that occur every other month that discuss business bylaws and procedures. The guys put in a lot of time, and they're pretty good. We're not looking forward to showing our skills, but someday we will, and I think we'll all be pleased.
Thank you.
I happen to have an opportunity to tour the van during that October storm. My part of Shore Road was being washed away there, and I was astounded at the communication capability you have within that vehicle, and also quite impressed with some of the training that the people on this team have gone through. I think one thing was they're learning to ride the surf in and land perched on the rocks when the wave goes out and things like this, and we do have somebody with that kind of background who is either on the team or an advisor to the team or something. It's just amazing to hear the kind of training these people are going through. And it says that the van itself was outfitted in just an amazing operational unit.
I think the good thing about the van is that while the WET team maintains it, it is a multi-departmental incident command center to be used by all of the different public safety departments.
Any other council discussion on the overall WET team goals and expectations? Bill?
With the number of radios that you have in the van, is that cellular phone necessity and why?
Well, the cellular phone complements our other communications abilities. No matter how well we try to prepare for our communications, there's always something that lacks at a scene. We've tried to cover all the bases, but the telephone, I think,
serves not only that lost link, but also a secured communications, if we need to have it back to either the public safety building or some other agency. It's a secure line. We don't order pizza, that's a joke, with the phone. The call back to public safety is a toll-free call, and it's really useful, I think, that way.
Okay, good.
Thank you. All right, page 97, the budget book. And this is budget item 225, part-time payroll, staying the same. Telephone. Maybe just read the amount, people are interested in those telephones.
You just want to comment, part-time payroll, Doug, even though the stipend was there, did not accept it this year, and instead had it go toward equipment for the wedding.
Very noble, thank you. Okay, part-time payroll, $750. Telephone, $200. Training, $400. Next page, maintenance, $250. Radio maintenance, $100. Equipment maintenance, $300. Gasoline, $135. Miscellaneous supplies, $100. Outlay, $725. Short ones, fun. Phyllis.
I have a question about on your outlay. You have a pager in the list of equipment. Are you... school nurses are having pagers, supposedly purchased for them by the school department. Are they the same kind of pagers, and can we get them, do you suppose, together and get a better price?
Well, we have tone-activated pagers that are similar and identical to the fire department's. And what we've done is we've complemented their supply of pagers to offset the number of non-fire department rescue personnel that we may have on our team. We currently lack about 3 pagers from non-fire department type personnel that the fire department now covers our needs and will continue to do so, provided, and not provided, but we have agreed that we will slowly add a pager a year so that it's not a real crunch. I mean, it's not a lot of money, except in our overall budget, that's $300 a year. So we're trying to add one a year, but it won't impact significantly. So it's basically this type of pager.
Do we know if it's the same kind of pager they're buying for the nurses? That's my question.
I don't know anything about it. But if the school department wants to buy our pagers, we'd be more than happy to let them.
I'm not sure they'll do that. Perhaps we can do a joint effort.
Okay. Any other questions on the WET team? On the WET team budget? Carl?
Just one. Doug. Has it ever been investigated as far as contacting the Coast Guard or other federal agency for grants of any kind? I know it's a big laugh, but
well, we've looked into
an ongoing process, you know, to keep sending them letters, say, look, we're still providing assistance to the local division here.
Yeah, we have looked into different organizations that offer grants for the type of work that we're doing. Mostly it's available on an innovation type thing because we are so unique. We have one of our members currently serving in Washington as a commander of the Coast Guard. And he remains an active member of our team on loan to the Coast Guard. And he is keeping his eyes open for that type of
thing. I figured as much.
We do work with Group South Portland on a number of different occasions. They have helped us in gear.
Okay.
They have helped us in communications.
Mm-hmm.
Not only providing, but helping us with our procedure for communications. They do serve a nice role, and we serve a nice role for them. So we do have a good relationship.
Thank you.
The extent to which we go to infiltrate the Coast Guard.
Go to all ends.
Okay. So the total requested budget for the WET team is $3,068 for the coming year. Thank you very much for being with us this morning.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
Taking a short stretch break for a few counselors here. Next item to be reviewed will be the police department. We have Chief Dave Pickering with us this morning.
Party's over, huh?
Party's over.
It'd be helpful when you start one.
Police budget begins on page 79 of your budget book. And I think you've heard the procedure that we want to follow.
Sure.
If you wait just a minute for people to get resettled.
How's the new situation? Good?
I have paid the bond in my yard every morning. Eight of them.
I stopped in the office this morning, had one bit last night.
One of them.
Is that a pass?
Would I have said that? Have you seen the 69? Dear.
Oh. Yes, darling.
Okay, Dave, let's get on.
All right.
Your presentation, thank you.
Just to kind of introduce the police budget. Last year, I guess one of the most significant decisions that was made was to reduce staffing by one position. And I'm looking over my notes from last year and saw that this council wanted to be informed as to how that has impacted on services and response. So I brought together a crime analysis for this year and last year. I know the last thing you probably need is more paperwork, but we will provide somebody to help you lug all this stuff out when it's done. So.
Is that Nick?
That's
we are doing recycling here.
Yes. It's big in the police department, I can assure you. You can see from this handout, our burglary rate is probably one of the most significant crimes of this year that's really impacted on services. Our burglaries have increased over 100% from last year. In 1991, calendar year 1991, we had 64 residential burglaries. Several of those were as a result of the Gypsy case, which we have all read about, and Detective Nichols did a great job on. We're still working on that, in fact. But we've had quite good success in court with that particular case. We're also fortunate that about 15 other burglaries that are part of this number were committed by one perpetrator, which we were successful in apprehending. So we have cleared up a lot of those, but I think it shows, you know, the impact that, that an economy can have on crime and how it reflects on the police services. Motor vehicle burglary, which where people break into cars, take tapes and whatnot, we're down a little bit this year. We're a little bit more vigilant, I think, in the areas of town where those crimes are prevalent, Fort Williams for one, Crescent Beach State Park as another. Theft complaints have increased about 29% to a total of 73 last year. Criminal mischief, for whatever reason, has increased dramatically, about 80% over last year. It's kind of one of those frustrating crimes. It doesn't make what we call our Part 1 crime category, the most serious offenses, but it certainly is important to residents when they have property that's destroyed or damaged, so we try to take those seriously as well. Complaints overall, these are our criminal complaints, have increased about 22% over last year, over calendar year 1990, to a total of 677, while our arrests, you'll notice in the next column, have stayed significantly the same. And I also think that reflects on the demands for services that are being placed on us right now. We're not making a great deal of progress in terms of arrests. Our clearance rates are up slightly, but I think probably due in large measure to those offenses I spoke about, those multiple offenses that we cleared with one arrest. Assaults are down, so even though people are stealing, they're apparently happy about it because they don't seem to have as many assaults as we did last year. Motor vehicle theft stayed pretty much the same as last year. So that kind of gives you a little bit of an overview as to what we experienced last year in terms of crime and what we had to deal with throughout investigations. clearly the demand for police services is, and predictably so, greater in this kind of economy. As far as our successes go, we've been quite fortunate. I think that all the officers have maintained a good attitude through this past year, despite, you know, the setbacks, despite the demands that are being placed on them. Even though the detective's position is part-time, I think Jack Nichols is doing a superb job. Our patrol officers are following up more routine cases and allowing him to handle the cases that take a great deal more time. Additional to his investigative duties, he is also our court officer. I can't begin to tell you how the court procedures have changed. It's something that I'm going to be concerned about in this next budget. One of the areas that we attempted to mitigate costs last year was to have our court officers schedule all of our cases when our officers rotate through day shifts. We have a rotating schedule and everybody comes through day shifts every 6 weeks for a two-week period. We saved a significant amount of money by doing that, several thousand dollars. When an officer came on day shifts, he had his court cases to go to. He could leave town, we still have coverage. I was available if something happened in town. So it worked out well. Since that time, beginning this year, they started a violations bureau, which is centered in Lewiston. Now we have lost all control of court scheduling. The Violations Bureau actually schedules all of our court cases. So what that means is, and I spoke with Jack Nichols about it yesterday, is that our officers, particularly our most active officers, the ones that are most aggressive on the road, do not rotate through day shifts during the weekday. So that's going to mean that we're going to be paying those people overtime. I've met with the district attorney on this. We've met collectively and individually with her about this problem. We've met with the court administrator about it, and presently they want to see how it works. So I'm not sure if this will continue throughout this fiscal year or not. If it does, I think that's going to impact, and it's an uncontrolled cost that we're going to have to deal with at some point in time. Similarly, another area of cost that we attempted to mitigate last year was I ordered all of the officers to take vacations during the day shifts. And again, for the same reasons that we could run those particular shifts light. Hesitant about doing that because, number one, these are officers that work Christmas, they work 4th of July, they work late shifts, they work during hurricanes, and they'll have a lot of time with their family, and I think it's important to allow them the vacations that they want. By the same token, we saved a considerable amount of money, and you will see when we go through the budget that money was put back in this year because we had that particular order was grieved, as you are undoubtedly aware, and we elected to adjust that policy so that officers who have 4 weeks vacation due then may take two on any particular shift. All other officers may take 1 week's vacation on any particular shift. So that increases the impact on this budget by 13 weeks vacation. Very simple to do the math. We're talking about $170 per overtime shift times 5 shifts times 13 weeks. You get to be a big number, and that is not including benefits. So those are two areas that are pretty much uncontrollable. Areas that significantly impact the budget, and I just want this board to know that we do everything we can to hold down costs when it comes to court time and everything like that. Sometimes we come up against those loggerheads, unfortunately. Well, I began to prepare this budget this year. I think, you know, I sense your frustration as well as others in the community in trying to save some money, and I thought it would be helpful if we went through and took a look in terms of dollars and compared ourselves with other communities to see how we're doing. We, last year, had reported to us $257,000 in stolen property. That includes property stolen from burglaries as well as motor vehicle burglaries and other thefts. Of that number, we had recovered about $160,000. So economically, you can see the impact we're having despite the restraints that have been placed upon us. And we would hope that to have that same level of success next year. In looking at comparative communities, I'm going to hand this off so we don't disturb the microphones anymore than we have. I went back this year and I took a look at the 7 communities that I think this council selected as comparison. One was Cumberland, another Falmouth, Freeport, Gorham, Scarborough, Windham, and Yarmouth. There was an article in the Cape Courier about these findings last year. I'll try to explain it in a little bit more detail to you this morning for the benefit of your deliberations. On the first page, probably the most significant figures that we see there is column E and F, which are the PD budget. The first column E is without benefits. Second one is with benefits. The reason why those numbers are separated is because some communities include their benefits in their budgets, others do not. I have provided both figures under the Cape Elizabeth Row. See, so we have one figure there of $628,000 without benefits and $810,000 with benefits. As you can see by those numbers, we are second to the bottom on actual budget costs, what the actual PD budget is in comparison with other communities. In the second column with benefits, there's only one other community that is lower than we are. So I think that's kind of indicative. And in fact, those two communities that are lower in the first column have significantly lower population than Cape Elizabeth does. On the second page, I broke down the police department budget as a percentage of tax revenue, again, with benefits and without benefits. In either one of those columns, there was only one other community of those seven comparative communities that were lower than we were. I think another significant number to look at here is under column P, which is population served per officer. If we broke the town down into people per officer, each police officer would be responsible for about 805 people. The only other community that comes close to that is Yarmouth, which has 780 people per officer. So basically the demands on our offices are the opportunities for calls for service, the more people, we have more people to protect, in other words, than other communities do. That also translates to officers per 1,000 population. We are the lowest in that category. We have 1.24 officers for every 1,000 people in the Cape. And again, the next closest community to that is Yarmouth, 1.28. On the final page, I broke down some cost per capita. Again, with benefits and without benefits, you can see we're still on the bottom of the scale there. There's only one other community in all of these categories that fare better than we do as far as the actual cost for police services. When you break that down to cost per equal population served, in other words, if all of these communities were serving 804 people like we were per officer, there's significantly less expenditure on the Cape than six out of the seven communities that we've identified here. And in the last column, we broke down the amount of property that our officers protect. Per officer, we're protecting $52,566,000 worth of both residential and commercial property. Again, the only community that comes close to that is Yarmouth, and I would assume that Cousins Island has a significant impact on that number. So I think what that tells us is we're running as efficiently as possible. When we compare ourselves with other communities, our officers are reasonably well paid. However, they are certainly not the highest paid in this group, nor are they the lowest. I think we are providing the level of service that the community demands, and I think that our budget in past years have been reflective of that. I'm a firm believer that the biggest argument against privatization is it ignores the fact that police services, public safety services, only rise to that level that the community demands. I don't have people coming in my office saying that we have too good a police service or too good a fire service or too good a public works. I think we are providing what the community is requiring of us and nothing more, as I believe this indicates to me. So with that introduction, I'll defer to the chair if you want to go line item or whatever.
We'll get to that, guaranteed. This is the first major department we're dealing with today. And I do want to go back to the procedure that I outlined earlier. I want us to take a few minutes before we get into the line item by line item and talk about what our expectations are of the police department and the services they have provided, the level of services that we expect and the level of delivery we expect. There has been talk about, oh my gosh, we're going to have to cut the police coverage down to one patrol officer operating at a time on the road. I will start the discussion by saying, from everybody who's talked to me, my own personal belief, that is not acceptable. And if there's any variance in another counselor's mind from that, that's a place to start. Otherwise, we will assume that is not acceptable. The level of service we expect to see provided is two patrol cars on the road. Do we have any discussion on that?
And that's what we currently have?
That's what we currently have. That's our target deployment.
Have we ever gone below that?
There may be a time if we have an arrest and somebody has to be taken to the county jail or somebody has to be transported to the hospital or what have you, that might be, but that's not what our target is, and that's not significantly what happens.
It's our standard.
Our standard is 2 officers.
That is what it is right now. There had been talk that might be reduced to one on the road at a time, and I just want to, okay, that's a good place to start. Any other comments about level of service expected, hoped for from the police department? Do you have any general information on rate of response time?
3 minutes on average.
3 minutes.
Which is slightly better than the average. It has been timed, in fact.
I know last summer I had occasion to make more or less a nuisance call, and that was about the response time.
But it was important to you.
It was extremely important at that moment, yes. For those of you who don't know, you have a snake in your house. The police department does respond and will remove the snake from your house. But you'll be harassed and joked about it for the rest of your life in a very good-natured fashion.
I don't know, but we have people to handle it.
The neighbors aren't home sometimes. Okay. Other expectations of the police department? There is always a dispatcher available.
Yes.
Right? And I think that is certainly something we're expecting to keep rather, you know, it's been, okay, maybe we can stay with that for a moment. There's been some talk about regionalizing the dispatching services. Is that something that we are interested in pursuing? Jane says yes. Can you give the reasons for that?
Hotels save us money and provide the same services we have looking at.
Has that been looked at all recently?
That was looked at in 1980, and I know that because it was the year after I made chief, and the counselor had brought that up. We did a fairly comprehensive study of that. You get a couple of very big, very major issues with that. Number one is that it would follow that if we regionalized dispatching services, we'd also begin to network our computer services. That has been successful in the Bangor area. It has not been successful in Greater Portland because so many departments do not want to share the database. I think that might be a natural catalyst to regionalization if we were to do that. But of course, Portland having the largest database available for criminal records, they're kind of in the driver's seat as to that. Also, I would be very concerned if we did not have somebody here, somebody that people can come to 24 hours a day. I think that's what the community wants, and I'm not sure how regionalization would work if we have one central dispatcher, perhaps either in Portland or what have you, maybe pick up on the 911 project or enhanced 911 project and just have our dispatching services through there. But I think that you would see a huge void in service if you did not have somebody here that could, you know, give out the permits and address the questions. And we've had several people come into a station in the last year that have been injured. The police department or the police station just is a central area where people go and they need help. And I think it would be a grave disservice to this community to take that away. So I think those are the things we have to address with regionalization. I think there are some things that we can do. I think it's important to note that I don't have a secretary, nor have I ever had, I guess probably in 10, maybe even longer than that, 12, 13 years. The dispatchers do all of our correspondence. They do all of the clerk duties. They do all the typing for the officers. So they're really a valuable part of this particular division. So those are some things we're going to have to look at. And I don't see it taking place, not necessarily because of Cape Elizabeth, but because of other communities for a long period of time.
I know at a recent COG meeting that both Dave and I were impressed with, there was an officer from Portland department, and one of the things he spoke about was the computer networking, and I'm hoping that's something we can follow up on. I think that it made a lot of sense to me, and I think it's worth further investigation.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that, because next year I will be coming to you in my five-year plan with monies for a mobile data terminals, which will be a prelude to that. We will have the equipment in place to regionalize at least communication from the cruisers. Right now we're waiting for the state to see what they do on that. I understand that there has been money that was set aside this year because of the budget situation, but there are monies in place to implement mobile data terminals. And what that will do is allow our dispatchers to not have to run what we call 1028s and 1027s, or license checks and registration checks. So that may begin to address the issue of workload on dispatchers. If we can run that from the car, that might be something that we can adjust in terms of manpower at some point in the future. But We're going to have to start getting up to speed in technology if this is what we want at some point in the future. And that's going to come back in capital improvements. So you can expect that if that's the direction we're traveling, and that's strategically what we want to accomplish in the next 4 or 5 years, there's a cost factor involved.
Other general comments and or concerns about the overall police department operation, Bill?
Well, I agree with the chief 100% in what he said about a dispatcher. That although as a lot of these people speak about the dispatchers, they figure all they do is dispatch. There's so much other work that's being done there by the dispatchers. And also there's people coming in there late in the evening, early in the morning. They're either hit a deer, they got locked out of their car, and there's somebody there. And I would think, regardless what you did as far as dispatching, you should have somebody there for the public to come in and get some questions or get a police officer in off the road.
I don't think that point should be lost either, as the chairman said. We went to a meeting a couple of nights ago, Janet and I, at COG. And I think one thing that the officer from Portland talked about was reducing police services to absolute emergency response. That's a luxury that we have in this town. We are not simply an emergency response operation, and I don't think the community wants us to be. We tend to be more service-oriented, and I think that speaks well of us. The community is demanding, and I also think that speaks well of the community. And it's those kinds of services that aren't, quote, emergency services that people enjoy in this town. And I don't think it's something that they're willing to give up for the sake of money, quite frankly.
Jane, did you?
Yeah, I had a question about, or a comment, I guess. The major concern I have with the police budget this year has to do with the cost, the increase in salaries. Because every other employee in town, except for members of the police union, will be receiving no increase this year. And from what I understand from what the school department says, that's going to be pretty much the case in the school department as well. I guess I'm really disappointed that there's one department in town, and one only, that is not participating in what we're all finding to be a really, really difficult year. And I think it makes it extremely difficult for the other employees. I just like your reaction to that.
Before he gives his reaction, I'd like to just let everybody know what has transpired up to this point with the situation. We have had the police association, which includes dispatchers and
sergeants
and patrolmen, thank you, I'm going to get that one right, is currently in the finishing, coming to the end of the second year in a three-year contract. For fiscal year 93, they would be in their third year of a three-year contract. The council, a couple of months ago, came to a consensus that we were looking for a 0% salary increase for all municipal employees. Understanding our situation with the police association, we directed the manager to go back to that association and request that they open up negotiations specifically to discuss salaries. Conversations were held with the police association. This is one of the very first times that when the counselor was in attendance at that kind of meeting, because the council agreed this was such a serious situation and such an unusual situation that we'd go back to an entity already in a contract situation, that we did have a counselor present at least the first meeting of the town and the police association. And so conversations have been held. To date, no progress has been made. The budget process is not over. I don't know how much hope we realistically could hold out that the police association would come back to us with something that the council would find acceptable. If they do not, I'm under the impression we're going to have to come up with about another $30,000 to cover these salaries and attendant benefits. Just so that's where things are right now, Dave.
I want to be real careful in addressing this question. It's a sensitive issue, which I'm very much aware of, and I'll ask Mike to keep me on target so I don't get involved in an unfair labor practice issue. I think one of the things that was difficult for this council as well as the police department was it's tough to sit down and just have a one-on-one conversation, kind of, you know, what are we going to do about this contract? The union's position, the association's position, is that when we sit down and we begin to discuss specific contract items, that is in fact opening up negotiations. They felt that they were being legally exposed, I guess, in that situation, and that's part of contract law. Their attorney was beside them every step of the way in that, and I think suggested they not do that. So it really wasn't a one, you know, there wasn't any exchange. I think the council proposed something. If that was not significant enough to encourage the association to give back the 5%, then that was the end of the conversation. And I hope I'm portraying that correctly. You couldn't sit down like we do in negotiations and say, I'll do this for you if you do this for me. And that was one of the problems we had in that. I still feel that the association, given proper incentives, would move on the contract. That is my feeling, and again, I want to be very, very, very careful about that because I'm not speaking for them, and I may be way off base. But I think they see a contract as a legal obligation, no less binding than any bond that's been issued in this community. I happen to agree with that as well, and they feel that to give back something, they should be able to enjoy something in return in better times. And I guess I would leave it at that. I'm still not convinced that they wouldn't do something on that. I think given the confines of the questions that were proposed, they had no other choice than not to address them. And that's where we came from.
It is an unusual situation. It's uncomfortable. I know how uncomfortable it is on the council side, having been an association member in another life somewhere else. I know how uncomfortable it must be on their side as well. Any other discussion on this topic? Bill?
When you say topic, what do you mean?
About the salary.
Salary? No, I have nothing on that, but I got something else.
Okay, we'll get back to it. Let's deal with, anybody else want to deal with the salary?
I think the chief, you know, explained it well in his comments. Of what he said is almost exactly what I would have said. It is the real sense. It's just like any other business contract. It ought to be honored. You know, I think it's our hope that, you know, business partners would recognize that the other partner is having financial difficulty as well, and that, you know, there perhaps should be some discussion on it. However, like any business agreement, that they like to have things that once things improve, if there's something out there in the future, you know, make good. The association's made very clear that they're interested in continuing the health insurance at the current level for perhaps another year. As we all know, that's a very expensive benefit that is currently, we're still offering 100% of full family medical insurance for all the full-time employees, both union and non-union. One of the council's goals this current year is to work toward developing a cafeteria plan so that it could be implemented within the next year. That is the association's concern on that issue is directly opposite to the priority of the council to begin to get control of health costs.
I just want to say I think both the chief and the manager have given very good synopses of the situation from my understanding of it. Jean?
Yeah, I guess just one final comment on my part on this whole situation is that I keep going back to the one-town concept that we've been working under in this town for a long time. And I see what some of our neighboring communities have done as far as their employees who are also involved in associations, et cetera, as far as pulling together in really difficult times. And I think we've been very fair over many, many years to all of our employees. And when we find ourselves in really difficult times that we're in right now, I really would hope that there would be a special effort this year to remember the one-town concept.
I think one of the issues I hear, not only from the police department association employees, but also from the others, is the other employees are very concerned that the police department get this. No one else gets it. The other issue I keep hearing is, and I think you addressed it, that your choice of wording, the school department is pretty much going to be the same. there's a lot of question as to, to use your term, what pretty much means. And there's the, all of the town employees are watching that very, very closely.
It gets very hard when you're trying to get something down to black and white, and there's still so much gray involved. And looking for equity at every level is perhaps going to be more idealistic than it is realistic. I don't think it's a goal we should give up by any stretch of the imagination. And it distresses me as well. I share your distress in that.
I think geographically we see quite a difference in contracts that are standing today and contracts that are being negotiated today. I don't think our officers would certainly expect a 5% increase if we were sitting around a bargaining table this year, quite frankly. So.
Carl, you had a question before we get into this.
Well, yeah, but it was not related to benefits. It was going to lead up to that eventually. But I'll try to bring it back. I'll go backwards into this. One thing that's always brought up is benefits and increase in salary. And Michael's brought up the fact that we're trying to get a cafeteria plan, but I think it was 2 years ago, or at least a year ago, that was first talked about. And I wanted facts and figures as far as higher deductibles, how would that affect the average employee, and let each employee take a look at the pact and say, how much benefit do I get? I mean, are they going to the doctors twice a year and they're getting a $5,000 benefit and they're only using $200 of it? Would they rather say, geez, you know, I'd rather take an extra $200 a month home in my pocket and have a basic policy with a higher deductible? You know, and that's a frustration, you know, do you weigh your benefits, which no one wants to give up, but it's a 40% part of the salary.
Well, demographically, I think there's some real value to a cafeteria plan. I think, you know, the officers that are married and whose wives work have the option of some insurances, and I think they take advantage of that and would reduce the cost significantly on this side. But same thing's happening in the private sector as happening in the public sector, perhaps even more so. So I think the longer we wait on that, the less attractive it, you know, it may become. But that's something I think that they'd be interested in looking at. I think it's something that we can work toward in the next contract. I'd certainly like to see that. Let me say that they are very well aware of what the cost of insurance is. They see it as a significant benefit. And when you see something as a significant benefit, you tend to fight for it harder. I don't know, but we would have been better off trying to lose this level of insurance a few years ago, because they didn't really appreciate what it cost. And now they know. And when you factor in the fact that you'd have to make more money to clear enough money to pay for this benefit, it is significant, much more significant than a pay increase in terms of real dollars. So it's going to be difficult, but I think a cafeteria plan is something that's attractive to a lot of officers. And as our department matures and people get married and have children, it's you really realize how truly valuable a benefit it is.
I think this kind of discussion is something that, you know, we could have with every department that comes before us today. We do have some specific items in the agenda to talk about employee benefits and payroll issues, and I think I'm not cutting it off, but I'm glad it's brought up now. We are going to delve deeper, perhaps, into these thoughts,
perhaps
get to those specific issues, but this is a good time to start, because this is the one association we deal with. Perhaps. Not that Dave represents the association either.
No, I'm very clear about that. Perhaps this is what should be regionalized, though, is a comprehensive insurance benefit package. Mm-hmm. I mean, if we're going to regionalize something, let's look at that and try to defray costs amongst, you know, member groups.
Yeah, I've been working with MMA, trying to encourage them to do that. The Health Trust, which is actually separate from MMA, but is headquartered in the same office and has a lot of similar, mostly the same people we know running it, one of their major goals this year is to develop a statewide cafeteria plan, one that they would administer, but that one that you know, people could choose from a full menu of opportunities.
That may be some of the best news we hear today. Mm-hmm. What I've always admired about Jane Amrow is her constant vigilance about salary issues and benefit issues. And I'm going to miss that from you, Jane. I think it's helped my awareness of the continuing accumulative costs of those issues and any kinds of flexibility we can get in there and still treat our employees the way we want to treat them. And I think that's another overall goal, more or less, that, you know, we could speak to, not only for the police budget, but for every budget. How do we want to treat our employees? That goes along with that.
If I could say one thing more on this to get for the benefit of the public, and the council as a reminder, our total health insurance cost for all employees is $218,450. We're talking a significant amount of money.
You certainly are.
And how many employees does that include?
That includes about 46 in their families.
5,000.
Yeah, the full family is budgeted in the budget at $5,111, which assumes a 10% increase on January 1. The current rate is actually 5% less than that. And then just the single is about half that, and then there's a couple other rates in between. If someone has children and no spouse, and there's another rate. If someone is older, is partially covered by Medicare.
Carly, Julia, anything else you wanted to touch on?
No, I was just going to get back to where we were before we started.
Okay, go.
Dave, back to we were talking about levels of service that were expected in the snake incident and whatnot. Do you have statistics or numbers that could be presented as far as what the actual cost is per call, non-emergency type call, response, false alarm type response? And are there fines ever assessed against false alarms after a certain part? You know, that was one thing that one of the meetings that we had at the National League of Cities. Towns and cities were becoming very aware of actual cost, and the taxpayers just took it for granted and says, well, we pay for it anyways, but the actual compensation back for that cost is never met.
We can develop that number. I wouldn't have that today, and we'd have to break out. Well, actually, we'd have to categorize what we consider to be non-emergency, and sometimes that's a little subjective.
Say something. Does that mean if my snake disappeared, I would have been fined?
No.
We have to be careful.
No. But I just, you know, and I'm not saying that there's other alternatives versus the police, but that's the first one that comes to mind. I mean, I've had several customers that have, you know, heard something and something that went thump in the dark in the night, and it was a deer rubbing up against the house. But to a single woman living by herself, that is
absolutely
more of an emergency than,
absolutely,
you know, hitting the same deer.
We can break that number out, though, and to get to your other questions, there are several areas that we do impose fines on for false alarms and the alarms themselves, audible alarms and subscriber alarms is one area. In fact, I think we were probably the first community, maybe even in the state, to do that, and that was back in 1979, and Chuck Wilson and I worked on that, and we've had great success with it. After three alarms, the subscriber's fine $25. Our false alarms have reduced significantly. I think partly because of that, partly because improvement in technology. You know, alarm systems are just more reliable today than they were several years ago. We are also imposing subscriber fees for just residential alarm owners. We've got the mailing list developed on that. I've been trying to time that properly. I didn't want to make it too close on the heels of Christmas and other, you know, expensive holidays we have to put that out. But we are moving in that direction. Kind of a cafeteria plan for police service. In fact, if you expect greater service from the police department, should you not expect to pay a little bit more? And I think the people at alarm services, you know, expect a higher level of service. You have two officers which are going to be coming in an emergency response mode if your alarm goes off. So yeah, we've looked at that. And again, we try to balance out what we assume is service that is provided for due to taxation and other demands that individuals place on the department. So it's ever present in our mind.
Okay, because that, you know, once again to stress this particular community that was used as an example, you know, I think they implemented a fine after the second one, which was way below the cost of the actual call. The second time that they went beyond that, it was closer to the call, and then the third time it was almost double what the cost was. And when they looked at the difference of, I guess, non-emergency alarms went from $150,000 to $200,000 of the budget, actual cost, down to about $50,000. You know, so just the impact, people think, wow, you know, maybe I better be a little more careful when I walk in.
We had one system that went off 54 times before we enacted this ordinance in 1 year.
This is something we did, we worked on that ordinance last year.
Yeah, we've made some adjustments to that, that's right.
Is that, that's the kind of false alarm you're talking
about? Oh, yeah, oh, yeah. That definitely.
Just clarify.
That would probably pay into the budget. Thank you.
Any other general issues or larger issues?
I just want to say, and I'd like to have the chief look into when they have these swim meets and what have you down to the high school and other function. When they have a basketball game, they have to hire an officer or two. And I would think, and the way the traffic has been down there on swim meets, that I think that should be looked into. And we get a recommendation from the chief, and I think they should be assessed along with anybody else, because it really gets plugged up down there at times. And I think you'll agree to that.
I agree, and I know what instant you're speaking about to kick this thing off. And just to tell you what we've done on that at this point, we have talked informally with Frank Miles and Rick DePusco about that, as well as I touched base with Connie Goldman on it a couple of days ago. We're waiting for the acting fire chief to come back, and we're going to address several issues down there. One is capacity issues, another is traffic issues, which seems to be something that we keep coming back to when it comes to the high school. But that will be a recommendation of mine, that when they're expecting a significant number of people, to ensure that capacity limits are kept, that they have either somebody from the fire department to get down there and monitor that, as well as a police officer to monitor traffic. It's a troublesome area down there. It's a great resource, and people, you know, should be encouraged to use it, but we've got to do it with some level of control, and I would agree that we have not had that up to this point. So
it's another issue when the school department comes back on their big project. They still need more parking down around the back of the high school, or in where the principal's office is on that big field there. There's a real problem with capacity close to the building, and people like to be close to the building, and if there aren't parking places close to the building, they're going to park close to the building anyway. So I would hope that might be an issue that would be addressed. You know, for example, just moving the kindergarten down there, they're adding, you know, who knows how many staff members or whatever, and, you know, there needs to be some thought given to, you know, how many more, and I think the argument some thought with drop-offs and whatever, but, you know, you need to give thought to, you know, what do you keep adding and what the effect of it is.
Going back.
I think that's an excellent idea, but I'd like to bring it up to the architectural people that designed that school and the committee, because it's in the committee wanted parking up next to the school, but that was wrong, and the people at the meeting said they wanted grass and lawns around it and let the people walk. One of those instances down there, there was hardly any cars up in the upper parking lot, and they were all double parked and all jammed in together down around the school. I agree with what you're saying. You've got to have your parking, but we couldn't convince the group at that time to do that, and I guess maybe we were a little bit foresighted more than some of the others, but that's where it should be. And another thing I'd like to mention about the dispatching area, I'll get back to that, it's one that I think I forgot. Why that person is valuable there. Whenever there's a school function, a lot of time there'll be some youngsters that don't have the dime or the quarter and what have you to make a phone call, will stop into the station and ask to call the parents and what have you. And I would hope that would continue, and it doesn't make the youngsters feel that a police station is a place to stay away from. And there's quite a few that will come in there at certain functions. And on the alarm deal, I listened very closely to that. And as far as the alarms go, that go off, I'm 100%. But I don't want to get into a situation that if Grammy calls up and hears something, that somebody don't respond if she's there alone.
No, that's not an alarm. False
well,
alarm,
that's what I'm saying.
I mean electronic alarm.
It only takes one step at a time to move up the road or down the road. That's all I'm trying to say. The alarms, I agree with 100%, I worked on it when it was first put in. Mm-hmm. But you mentioned about the meeting you went to about calls that are really, you might say, to some people would be a false. but to other people, they're very concerned about it, and I feel they should be available, just like that.
Time out, Bill. All right, the response and the alarms I'm talking about are, and the, I'm quite sure, and maybe the chief can enlighten me if this isn't the case, but I'm quite sure that as far as alarm systems that are set up for their security, someone walking through the door and setting off the alarm is not as important to the security agency as the emergency button pushed or the emergency pad. That signals a different response to the security company. And I think on the door alarm, they first try to contact the homeowner, find out if they're there. If they can't get someone, then they call the department. If it's an emergency call, I believe it's patched right through to you anyway.
That's correct.
Correct? The person that calls in and has a problem, I don't call that a false alarm, because obviously if they're there and they're calling in their concern, that's as well as them pushing an emergency button, say, I've got some problem. It's the accidental tripping of the alarm, forgetting that the alarm was on when you go outside for something, you don't even know your alarm's going up. Oh, did I do that? That's the type of response. And I know that there's a fine line, but I think that people can appreciate that they're not gonna be less response time if they call in and say, something's making noise outside my house. That's an emergency and it's not a false alarm. A snake, an emergency to that situation, it's not a false alarm. The false alarm is the one that's signaled by, you know, setting off an alarm that the emergency or the equipment company cannot determine. They can't get a respondent at home. Someone, it's mostly human error. That's the kind of response, and that's why you allow so many. But 54, I mean, there's easily, you can see that line, and everyone knows when they step over it.
Yeah, but that's an exceptional one. That 54, but Bill, there was a problem. But I just want to say they're going to be capped with it. Somebody could break into the house and not know where the alarm was and set it off. And I think they got to be thinking of whether they respond or not.
It's not going to stop his response. They're going to still respond to everyone. But when they get there and determine that it has been a false alarm, that's when the fines go back. They don't just say, geez,
they do that now, is what I'm trying to say. They do that now.
Okay. So that's what we obtained from the conversation.
Even if someone calls up and said, I messed up, I tripped my alarm, we send a cruiser code one or code two just to verify in every situation, even if the person's done it before. So, yeah, we're very much aware of that.
Yes, my teenage daughters will attest to that fact, that you do show up. I want to just, before we continue, I want to touch base back with Bill's initial question about the traffic at swim meets. And I think we need to make sure we include in the responsible parties dealing with that community services. Mm-hmm. I know I had a call from Sue Weatherby, and she said, we are changing our policies, and it's not just the high school administration, it's also community services in a situation like that. Bill, I want to give you my support in the dispatching services staying local. I think that's an expectation of this community, that there will be somebody in that building. It's one of the small town stereotypes that we have that is more than a stereotype. I think it's very vital to the feeling of Cape Elizabeth services being provided. Okay. Are there any other general concerns we need to touch on before we start flipping pages?
Let's go.
Okay, seeing none, let us start on page 82.
Now, I'm assuming that the that Michael's hen scratching here underneath the requested fiscal year 92, these are all inaccurate. They shall be 93?
Yes.
Everything's inaccurate in this budget. It shall all be 93, right?
Just a year off.
The heading's a little off, David.
Yeah, okay.
I'm glad you mentioned that, because quite frankly, I'm not sure what number I'm looking at anymore. I've redone the budget three times and then Mike's number, so we'll have to kind of go through this together. Yeah.
So
the important thing are the numbers that are on the computer sheets. Yeah. The other thing you'll see that I've done on the computer sheets is lump together all the overtime accounts, because I've been overseeing police department budgets for over a decade now, looking at them, and I've never seen them come out. The overtime accounts are always all over the place, so I'd like to try to keep track of every month from now on of where the overtime is out of one account, so I can track the whole thing rather than the others. But it shows up here, but the computer sheets, they've been all lumped together.
But for example, I mean, just to clarify, so we don't have to go through every paragraph on every item, your printing underneath the requested fiscal year 92, it should all be fiscal year 93.
Yep.
And basically, the bottom line that we started on this morning, the 4.1 million,
yeah,
assumes that those computer typed ins are wrong. It assumes your...
Yeah, that's
right. Right, okay. So all of the rationale underneath is assumed in your written-in numbers.
Except when, you know, someone has said they've provided 5%, even though I haven't crossed that out, you should assume that that's no longer there.
That's my assumption.
Every line.
That's my assumption.
As you look at the computer, you know, this, not the word processing, but the printout, those are the operative numbers.
That's page 10 of the printout that you got this morning.
Yeah. Those are the operative numbers. And those should reflect all of the reductions that we made during the process. I think there are a couple errors.
That's right.
I know there are a couple errors in the printout, but all to the good, but none of the errors, to my knowledge, were the numbers.
I'm seeing 13 accounts that need to be adjusted from these numbers. Is that...
Why don't you just start and then...
All right.
My problem initially is, in the book, it's account 1,000. Account 1,000 doesn't show up on the printout.
I've lumped together. That was the only department that separated administration from full-time. What I'm trying to do is simplify the accounting during the year so that we can better monitor it. So it's all in full-time payroll. It also helps with doing the expenditure by category.
Yeah.
Just on that account then, under full-time administration and full-time payroll, when you lump that together, it comes out to 340,000, and on the computer it's 330.
Have you reduced the 5% out of both?
All right, so you didn't go through everything, scratch it up.
Yeah, the computer sheet is the operative sheet, okay, and provides the amount you see in the budget minus 5%. And then there's a couple of things where I've made cuts as well that go beyond the 5%.
Okay.
So what we're seeing on the computer sheet, page 10, item 1001, full-time payroll, is 330,000.
But to satisfy the contractual obligation, it would need to be 343,000.
It's 30,000 if you have to add in the 5% back on here, but let's not try to add them all today, because hopefully we won't have to do that.
I think you should have it in there. That's what it is, and then you subtract it out.
We gave the manager direction to show all, to show a 0% salary increase. That's why it's like this.
You asked me to recommend a budget that had zero for everything. That's what I did.
With a zero tax increase?
Yeah. No, salary.
Billy, you might have recommended that.
I did.
I'm talking about the consensus of the council. We haven't brought that up for consensus yet. Did you have another?
Well, just again, my clarification is that these computer sheets imply that there is no 5% wage increase in any department with any employee with any benefit or anything else.
Exactly.
It's a bottom line.
Yes, exactly.
So we don't have to go through this discussion when every new person comes up here to present. Okay.
Right. And the Police Association is the only association we deal with. If we hold to the contract we have with them, then we would have to add about $30,000 in payroll. That includes payroll and benefits.
Yeah. The only change there is, there's a couple of step increases which are budgeted for, that I think if you look at the full-time payroll account, over every department, it's about $5,000.
But you're going to specifically address those when we come to them.
Yeah, they are included. The first ones are in fact in this full-time payroll account in the police department. We still have the step increases budgeted.
And I believe there are two in the police. One or two step increases.
I think through the whole department there may be four, dispatchers included.
Four with dispatchers.
But also the chief and the captain are not members of the bargaining unit, so they're exclusive from that other block of money.
That's correct. And in the 30,000 that we've referenced, everyone in the department, if we had to honor the contract, would get raises, but the chief and the captain would not.
Right.
They're the only two here this morning, too. Okay, so item 1001, $330,000. Okay. And that's for full-time payroll. Part-time payroll, $1,800. I'm just going to keep turning pages. If somebody has a question, check in. Want to keep moving here. Okay. Overtime payroll, $68,805.
Yeah, that includes 1,003, 1,004, 6, 7, 8.
So the pages aren't any good to me.
No, the pages are good because they give you a detailed explanation.
Well, I understand.
The numbers are no good, Billy. The numbers are no good on the pages.
The numbers were adding up.
Right.
In 1003, it's a decrease from the previous year. Holiday vacation pay, the chief spoke to us about reasons for some of that increase, with vacation time being taken during day shifts more often in the coming year. 1006 is sick time, and I think an important figure there is the officers use less than 3 sick days per officer per year, which is...
That's commendable.
Very commendable. Training replacement account is just about the same as it was last year. Investigative overtime account is budgeted at the same as it was last year, 2015. Court overtime account, a higher amount was requested. It was put as the same as this, I'm saying last year, the current year. Dave did speak to us initially about the fact that there may be problems with that if everything is scheduled out of Lewiston rather than us having a bit more control over it. Hopefully the state or whoever will see the light on that. So that, those are all of the items that are included in overtime. Are there any concerns or questions with those? That was through 1009. I'm on page 85 with that. At the bottom of that page, we have special assignment account.
What do we charge for our number?
$30.
$30.
For all members, so it's $120.
And that does cover cost?
Yeah, Mike and I sat down a couple of years ago, and we even consider factoring in the cost of a cruiser. I think we had some money in there for that, so it does include salary, benefits, and miscellaneous equipment. And that should be able to stand for another year before we have to make another adjustment on that.
And that's at $6,900.
Presently, I think our base overtime rate is around $21.25 per hour. So we've got about $9 per hour. What's happening in the benefits and equipment.
Okay. We even added 50 cents per hour for the billing cost of it.
Yeah. But it's got to be. I mean, that's a user fee that's justifiable.
I think the justifiable is the key word. It's good. Yeah. Next on the printout sheet is 1020, Social Security, $30,740. Main State Retirement, $29,900. Retirement plan, $13,000. Disability insurance, $2,080. Health insurance, $55,110. Workers' comp, $24,270.
Could I speak very briefly about those, since this is the first department, to just refresh everyone's memory?
Mm-hmm.
Social Security is 7.65% for all personnel. The Main State Retirement System is budgeted at 0.202 or 20.2% for those persons who are in the Main State Retirement System. New employees are no longer allowed to join that and instead belong to the ICMA 401A money purchase plan. The town contributes a 5% match to that. For those that are in that particular plan, there's a provision in the police contract as well as in the personnel code that the town will pick up to a premium of up to 1% of salary for a disability plan. Again, those are only for the people that are in the money purchase plan, not in the retirement system. That is budgeted at 0.8% of the budget. The current premium is 0.76 or 0.76% So, you know, one of the concessions made by the police association in the last contract was to give up the absolute right to join the retirement system. we're, instead of 20.2% for employees in the retirement system, we're paying for those in the ICMA and Unum, which is, sort of comes together, 5.76%. So, you know, I think that's an example of the direction the council wants to move in controlling benefit costs. And, you know, it shows that, you know, monies can be saved by looking at those issues. Health insurance, we've previously discussed. Workers' comp, in every account, you'll see wide variances in cost, and that's because under the rating system, you pay different for a police officer than you do for a dispatcher, than you do for a tree warden, than for a town clerk, administrative assistant.
Okay.
I won't discuss that from then on. But
yeah, I think that's a good overview for everybody to keep in mind as we get through the day here. Okay, I'm looking, I'm on page 86 in the middle, account number 2004, printing and advertising account at 500, dues and membership 300, okay. 87 training account, 6,000, conferences and meetings account, 400. Dave, I've got a question on that. Are any of those out-of-state meetings?
No, in anticipation of my induction in the main piece as secretary, that was bumped up a little bit, but those were only for in-house, in-state conferences.
Okay.
Three a year.
Three. Okay. Thank you. Item 2032, vehicle maintenance, $7,875. Does that take into account the possibility, you know, the definite situation of trading in only one cruiser rather than two?
Yeah, it takes it. We bumped that up a little bit in anticipation of only one cruiser. And, you know, if you are interested, I do have a. We called the Chevy dealership the other day and looked at the refurbishing schedule. And what we had tried to anticipate was keeping these cars for 2 years and completely refurbishing them. After they had 110,000 miles, they'd been on the road for 12 months, bring them into a shop, deadline them for 2 weeks, and have them go top to bottom. So we could actually start a second year with these cruisers as you know, brand new as possible. And the numbers are a little bit scary, but we do have a schedule of refurbishment for these cruisers, which includes a short block assembly for an engine and transmission and whatnot. So it's kind of a menu of what we could expect to pay if these repairs became significant in the second year of the cruiser. So I can just hand this out to you and you can see that to completely refurbish a car top to bottom is almost $10,000.
Do you want me to get some file folders and throw all this stuff in that you get today?
No. Just have the recycling bin ready.
Get the recycling machine.
Get the tray.
We're going to square open files instead of circular files. Not to say that it's not appreciated and used.
Come over the space and just put them through the spreader.
So that kind of shows what the well.
If we were to trade, if we were not to trade in two cruisers, so this would be a change. Already, our general practice is to trade in two cruisers a year.
Yes.
Okay. And it's budgeted for the coming year that we will only trade in one.
Yes.
What if we don't trade in even that one? What would that do to this vehicle maintenance account?
We would increase that. I think the number that we landed on was around $1,500 more.
$1,500?
Yeah. So you would reduce the cost of the cruiser and add $1,500 more in the maintenance schedule. And that's just absolute guesswork. I don't know if we're anywhere near that.
I'm going to put that on my list for revisit because I think that is one potential item we're going to be looking at, is not trading in any cruisers. That's
if I may, what when you purchase new cruisers, like last year, what have you, what would you figure would be the cost? Just take an estimate. What are we talking?
An estimate would be somewhere in the ballpark around $15,000. There are some offsetting revenues where you get between $1,500 and $2,000, either trading. We tend to sell them outright. We make a little bit better outright. So net in the area of $13,000 per cruiser.
And it takes 9 from there, 10,000 to refurbish.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anything else in vehicle maintenance? Page 88, radio maintenance, $3,000. Radio maintenance, we got one. Contractual services account, $4,500.
I gotcha.
We're already seeing double and triple lines here. Office supplies, $3,000. Gasoline, $12,000.
I have one on that.
Yes, sir.
I may. What do you figure the cost per gallon on gas?
Gonna talk about that a little later. We budgeted 90 cents per gallon. I don't think we need that amount. We're currently paying 65 cents. But I discussed this with Janet earlier. What I'd like to do is, we have a problem with the replacement of our gasoline tanks over there and how to fund them when they come along. One of the problems is we don't recover the cost, you know, our true cost of providing gasoline for different departments, and particularly the school department. What I'd like to do is to set up a system whereby, right now, Public Works overcharges like a nickel about a penny. They round up to the next penny to maintain the pumps. What I'd like to do is to instead have a system where everyone was charged 5 cents a gallon, that the money would go into a dedicated fund to replace the underground gasoline storage tanks. So that way, for example, when the school, particularly what it's aimed at, is when the school department reports their transportation costs and the gasoline costs, the last time, you know, we replaced gasoline tanks, you know, we could have gotten the school department to pay a proportionate share in the State Department of Education to do that through the subsidy. That would have been an allowable expense, but the way we do it, it isn't. So what I'd like to do is to set up a fund whereby every department, including the Public Works Department, is charged 5 cents a gallon. That would go into a dedicated fund that then the next time we need to replace a gasoline tank, that we could do it. Which, to answer your question, what I haven't figured out all the amounts, but I think we should budget, including that nickel, 80 cents rather than 90 cents, so we can save, you know, whatever, 10 cents per gallon throughout the whole budget on gasoline, and still set aside a nickel per gallon to eventually pay to replace not only the gasoline tanks, we also have the pumps over there that, you know, Billy, from having been over there over the years with fire trucks, are quite old at this point.
Okay, good.
Any comments on the proposal to set aside, to charge and then set aside that 5 cents per gallon? I thought that was a very sensible long-term approach to that situation and puts, you know, it puts the cost where it should be. Okay. So what I'm hearing, Mike, is overall in the budget, we won't do this as we go through, but at some point soon we'll have a 10 cent per gallon reduction on the gasoline accounts.
As you look at the expenditure by category in the municipal budget, the count is 3. 3002. The total amount we spend on gasoline is $21,245. So by reducing that by about 10%, we'll save a couple thousand dollars.
Okay.
Again, you know, I always, whenever we fool around with fuel costs, we just don't know. But I think 10 cents is a reasonable.
I just want to get a clarification here. Now, you've indicated to Michael that any surplus generated this year over $130,000 be placed in the ladder truck fund. Are we going to start having designated funds like for this, you know, tank removal? How's that going to affect the ladder truck if we, for example, had $5,000 extra in the gasoline
that
account?
Affect that at all.
So that's going to be an entirely different story.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good point. Thank you.
Okay, this would begin July 1. Begin prior to that.
Mm-hmm.
So it means that. I was curious what impact that would have on the school department. What it would do is potentially reduce that amount a bit in their budget also. They've got, I think, $25,000 scheduled for gasoline, but I wanted to make sure we weren't increasing to the school department the cost we were going to charge, and it sounds like, if anything, we'll decrease for them. Okay. Still on the police budget here. Back to pages. Uniforms account, $7,750. No comment about particular officers' physiques this year. Some of the highlights of past budgets. Minor equipment and tool accounts, $3,000.
I got a question on that one.
Yes, sir.
That DARE program, you figure with this budget you're going to be able to handle the way I read your notes?
That figure does not anticipate any income. Historically, we've gotten between $1,000 and $1,500 from the Lions Club. I think a lot of people are going to the well next year, so that's why I didn't, you know, that number is included in that, or doesn't anticipate that we're going to get any offsetting revenue. So, yeah, we should be able to handle that now.
I cut that by 500, Billy, telling Dave that I would find the $500 for him.
I've got that in my notes.
Charitably.
You've got that written down?
I've got that written down.
Okay. That sounds good, because I didn't want it to get, I think it's a good program.
It is, excellent program, very good response.
I would like to cover it up.
Thank you. Outlay account, $20,375. I'm going to stop here for a moment.
Yeah, on this, the photocopier went 10-7.
10-7,
could you explain that code?
10-7, no phone.
Yeah, so we were without a copy there. That has been purchased this year, so that can be cut out of this budget. As well as there's also an equal amount that you'll see in the fire department budget that can be cut out as well.
So we're taking out $1,375.
The purchase this year also reduced our printing and advertising costs. I took out the money that we had for maintenance agreement, where this was a first year purchase, so we saved about $850 there as well.
Chief, I made a note here, when you got down to the replacement of the cruiser and Bill asked it, you said 13,000. Now we're 16 here. What's the difference?
Net was 13,000.
Yeah, 13. Yeah. Okay, in other words, there's money coming.
Okay.
Okay. Bill?
I want him to run by me on this capital outlay, this audio recording system for the dispatch center.
That's a system that we've been looking at for the last several years. Presently, we record emergency incoming lines only, and there are three, 8-1, 8-2, and 8-3, and it's all on a trip down. That's the only lines that are recorded in the police station. So if somebody, you know, it's a fairly friendly town, so many people know what non-emergency numbers are. If they call on 3323, it would not be recorded. So all of you would likely call on 3323 if you had an emergency call. So what this particular system would do is it would record all incoming telephone lines that we have, as well as record all radio traffic from every public safety entity in town. It would record police, fire, rescue. I think at some point that might be valuable. You know, in determining what happened at a scene, all that's going to be recorded and kept in a file or kept in a repository somewhere, so we could refer back to those in case of a civil suit or what have you. The system that we have right now is an endless tape system. Certainly not advanced technology. It's about 15 years old. I think we've had the tape replaced a couple of times. So this is the next logical step. You know, to improve the technology and I think provide a little bit better service. But it's an expensive piece of equipment. But that has been deferred in this budget until next year.
Phyllis?
How much?
$22,000.
It is $22,000.
That is not included in the amount being recommended at this point.
If we ever had 911, don't they have automatic recording?
Yes. Well, because that wouldn't help us as far as radio traffic goes. We still wouldn't have any record of radio traffic. So that would be one thing that it wouldn't address. And quite frankly, I'm not sure where 911 is in the state. I think we're quite a ways off from that right now, several years. You're talking several million dollars to implement that.
What is the advantage of recording the radio traffic? How long do you keep it? What kind of records do you keep?
We would probably keep that a minimum of a year, depending on what it is. I can give you a good example where that might be. When the houses blew up down here on Woodland Road, and we got all of these different entities coming in and start, you know, pointing fingers as to who did what and where, all that information would be would be recorded. They could tell what lines are being laid and how the fire was attacked and, you know, how the police crews were set up. And if somebody got hit by a car, God forbid, we could go back and say, we had an officer there and here's what he said. So probably the liability more than anything.
I want to review that before we get done.
You want to come back to that?
Yeah, it's a high priority for me, except for the fact I'm looking for zero tax increase.
I'm still
heading in that direction. You know, I just thought we couldn't afford it this year.
Well, maybe we can, but I'd like to review it. In my review.
Dave, talk to me about light bars.
Again? We do this every year.
We do this every year. I'm becoming less convinced, I think.
Well, the light bars that we have presently, we have one new light bar, which I guess is a couple of years old, and it went the same way, the old one went the same way as the copy machine did. It just didn't work. We cannot get parts for those old light bars that we have presently. The new ones are much better. They're low profile. Supposedly, you save some money as far as, you know, cost savings in gas, presumably less wind resistance, etc. There's greater visibility, so probably we can say that we've got less opportunity to get rear-ended on a traffic stop or something because the lights are brighter, etc. This number would allow us to buy two other light bars. So all of the Mark Cruisers would have new light bars on them. Because we have one new one now, the other two light bars are old and we can't get parts for them. And we've been coming back. Do they work? Yes. Will they work tomorrow? I don't know.
This would be just like the copier. If you did cut this out of the budget, and if they went, I would hope it would be with the understanding that I could still go out and sign a purchase order for David for a replacement.
And I would say there's some benefit to group purchasing this kind of stuff. We've done that before, and we can get under a state bid and buy factory direct if I had the money and, you know, had a little time to do this. So we, maybe not a huge savings, but there's some savings to be able to do that.
Would there be a state bid on an annual basis for that kind of? I'm going to propose that we delete the light bar allocation.
Do what?
Deep six, whatever it's called. Delete the $3,000 for the two light bar replacements. You have a question on that one?
No, it hasn't.
No.
I would agree with the manager that it would be a similar situation to the copier, that if they happen to go without a specific allocation for them, that the money would be. Carl?
I was just going to say, anyone watching at home, donations are readily acceptable if someone wanted to purchase a light bar. It's a great deduction.
You adopt a light bar program.
Why not? You know? A little tag on you.
Would you put a plaque on it?
I just put a little tag on there, say this light bar donated by.
What about a lot of friends?
Right, you might want to be an anonymous contribution.
I'm going to suggest we delete one of them, not both of them. I don't know. I think, you know, this has almost become a joke to the council, these light bars, quite honestly, over the last two or three years. And Chief Pickering brings